Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam. It's a very special blessing to be here and to chant the prayer today at his birthplace. It's also a blessing to talk about two Mahatmas, Swami Chinmayananda and Swami Dayananda Saraswati ji, to see how they contributed to the Vedanta Sampradaya. Now, the tricky thing about a contribution to a Sampradaya is the traditional view and the academic view. The traditional view is that you are a contributor if you are a Sampradaya Vit, if you are loyal and adhere to the teaching tradition. The academic view could well be that I want to add something new, I want to integrate what already is, because I'm not able to see the meaning because I have not gone into the depth of the tradition. And so when we talk about what they have contributed to the Sampradaya, we obviously see them as Sampradaya Vit, not Sampradaya Krit, not trying to create their own tradition. Yet, because they articulated the different prakriyas without dumbing down the tradition, but they articulated in a contemporary idiom and also to contemporary times, so that is going to be the framework within which I look at both their contributions. So Arundhati, so yeah, we talk about Swami Chinmayananda first. Arundhati has done half my job, so I'm not going to repeat the same thing. We all know the times that Swami Chinmayananda spoke during. So I think the only one or two things I want to add in addition to what she already said is that Swami Chinmayananda broke through Brahminical orthodoxy. So that was very important at that time. And also gender exclusivity, because he was perhaps one of the first few people to initiate women into sannyasa, and as Arundhati has already very well articulated, that nobody was denied. Because also, just as Shankara speaks about in his Bhashya, we also have to account for Purva Janma Punya, okay, because of which people are drawn to this. And of course, we know about the modern, secular, English-educated person who was totally cut out from his roots. So I'm not dwelling on that too much. She has already spoken about the BMI chart, which was at that time, like she very rightly said, an entry ticket. It helped people to visualize certain things. And what is also unique is the fact that despite being a Vedanta teacher, he contributed to the very many elements of Sanatana Dharma in which the roots of Vedanta can really sprout. And so therefore there were programs for all ages. It was not only restricted to adults, so that, you know, with the recognition that we really need to have an early start. And then a couple of other things, which was, as perhaps one of the people have already stated, that he wanted to convert Hindus to Hinduism, very rightly said. And he also, in his own words, he wanted to hawk Vedanta. One of the other things that happened to families in the US was that they were again uprooted in more ways than one, and therefore in terms of the temple societies and also the Bal Vihar and all the other programs, he made a big contribution. So our koti pranams to this Mahatma. Then of course I go to Swami Dayananda Saraswati ji, who obviously need not be confused with Arya Samaj, Dayananda Saraswati. And he also happened to be the guru to our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and also in recent times to Rajiv Malhotra ji. Not that that's his claim to fame, but I'm just contextualizing. Swami Chinmayananda was one of his gurus, and there are many things about his contribution in the way in which he articulated the teachings. Of course, he was Shankara Anugai, and so therefore there was no diluting the tradition at all. Recognizing the pressure of modern times to make Vedanta scientific, to explain Vedanta in psychological terms, he just made one statement, which was, in psychology there is no solution and in Vedanta there is no problem. It is a brilliant statement which talks about the role of psychology. And just by the way, I trained as a psychologist in my Purvashrama, and so, and I also practiced for a long time. So he emphasized the role of psychology. He spoke a lot about the unconscious, and he also spoke extensively about how one can align Pratibhasika Satyam with Vyavaharika Satyam. He was totally in line with the tradition, and he accounted for how all the other methods, including yoga and tantra, how all of them contribute to Antakarna Shuddhi and Naishchalyam. At the same time, he obviously, because he was also addressing global audiences, he was very clear that psychology doesn't deliver the goods, it just helps us to manage life, but you know, there is no solution in it. But like in Vedanta, there is no problem, and he unfolded that in a very deep way. So it was very easy for him to also very clearly articulate that in this whole debate of, is Hinduism polytheism, pantheism, and the more recent debates, that he just struck off this, there is that one God argument, and he said there is only God, all that is here is Ishvara. And in his public talks, as also in the courses that he conducted, this was his primary emphasis, because the more real Ishvara was in a person's life, it was very easy to shift to the Swarupa of Ishvara, and therefore Tattvamasi obviously becomes very clear. Then of course he used and avoided certain words, and this is very important, and this is my request to a lot of academicians, that in, again, in our attempt to simplify or make ourselves understood, we use words that do not have translatables. Swami Chinmayananda already spoke about how soul cannot be translated as Atma, and likewise, because of Abrahamic connotations, it's better to avoid using the word God and replace it with Ishvara, because here we're talking about abhinna nimitta upadana karanam. Likewise, even Shraddha has a deeper meaning rather than faith. I have heard few people here use the word salvation. I don't quite know what that means, but we're talking about moksha here, which is freedom from the sense of bondage. Even the bondage is not real. And any attempt to conceptualize the teaching, small I, big I, self, small self, big self, while our intentions are wonderful, but it is further adding to conceptualization, and he just sort of broke through all of that. Another very important thing, and I had a bit of a discussion slash argument with one person here, can't see him now, about the word mithya. Vedanta is not understood, I find, in large circles, because satyam and mithya is not understood. And here mithya, the translation, unfortunately, is false and illusory. And Pooja Swamiji always emphasized that where there is mithya, there is satyam. It is just an ontological word pointing to the status of reality. And so therefore it has a dependent existence. It's paratantra satta, it is not swatantra. So this is something that really needs to be assimilated, because when we translate it as false and illusory, we are losing out on the depth of meaning that the word mithya has in the context of satyam, obviously. In the 3 days that we've been here, I have not heard much about Vedanta as a pramanam. Vedanta is not a system, it is not a school of thought, although in academic circles perhaps it's presented that way. Unless Vedanta is seen as a pramana, pramakaranam iti pramanam, a means of knowledge, we will struggle with conceptualizing it, we will struggle with visualizing it, we will struggle to make it more scientific so that it gains validation, and we will also try to dumb it down. So there is enough and more said in Vedanta Paribhasha which can be added to our understanding. But here, just as my eyes are a pramana for me to see, the words of the Shastra are a pramana for me to see the truth of myself. I am partially known, I am self-evident, Swata Prakashas and Swata Siddha, but what I am is not known. So the Shastra is only pointing out what I am. I am is already self-evident. And so unless the words of Vedanta are not used as a pramana, the thinking will be very conceptual, and you are not a concept, so why would you conceptualize yourself? And then, how much time do I have? Another 5 minutes? Yes? Yeah? Okay. So this is a very important thing that he emphasized, all in line, of course, with the Bhashya. In fact, at the end of, I think, the first sutra, Bhashya says, Tasmat Siddham Brahmanaha Shastra Pramanakam. So it is not something that Swamiji emphasized or he reinvented. He was just in line with the tradition. And therefore, the pressure to prove Vedanta as a science doesn't hold valid, because science is based on perception and inference, which are two independent pramanas. So when you are saying that Vedanta is a pramana, we are saying it is the sixth pramana. That which perception and inference cannot reveal is what is revealed by Vedanta. So we have no qualms with science. In fact, we will use many scientific arguments to talk about Vyavaharika Satyam. So there's a lot to be said, and this could well be a book, not only just a paper, but I will proceed. Then, in modern Vedanta, I mean in the English translations and how Vedanta has been taught over the last, let's say, 75 years, a lot of confusions have crept in for different reasons. And a lot of teachers have, again, well-intentioned, but some of these confusions that are there is that all religions lead to the same goal. So of course we have sarva, we have ekatma bhava, but let us not dilute the tradition. The second thing, and again this is something I would love to debate with someone on, which is that, which I've heard over here, is that self-realization is a special experience. Now if you look at the definition of an experience, it is based on sense data. And if it is an experience, it will start in time, it will end in time. So are you saying moksha is a state of experience? I mean, there are lots of arguments, but I'm not delving into it. But this is something that he re-established, that it is not an event sitting under the Bodhi tree, nor is it a special experience, because it will end in time. It is the truth of who you are. And likewise, we are not being dogmatic here. We are not even trying to accommodate and say, oh, all yogas will lead to moksha. Very clearly, if the problem, human problem, is not articulated as one of avidya, then all these matas can hold. But if the human problem is articulated as avidya, then definitely the only solution is jnanam. And this who am I inquiry, in the absence of the Shastra, even if you go deep within, will not reveal the Atma. Because very clearly it is said, asampradaya vit murkhavat upekshaniyaha. So please, ignore the ones who are not with the sampradaya. And a couple of last points, which is in addition to how he contributed in terms of his pedagogy and the way in which he brought Shankara Bhashya alive to all the ones who studied with him, he also contributed extensively to Hindu Dharma and therefore the formation of the Hindu Dharma Acharya Sabha, which was bringing together a lot of the Mathadipatis so that Hindu Dharma can speak with one voice. So it has been very instrumental in many initiatives, including the Indo-Jewish dialogue and also the Indo-Buddhist dialogue. And then in a very pioneering way, he did make the statement, conversion is violence, in 1999 at the Dharma Rakshana Samiti, which then eventually became adopted by the UN in 2008. This is very important in the context of religious conversion and how we view it and what needs to be done about it. So there's much more that all these Mahatmas have done, and I've just covered a tiny slice of their contribution to the sampradaya, them being sampradaya wits. Om Tat Sat.
Thank you. To see how both the gurus worked together, in the late 60s, Swami Chinmayanji founded the Vishu Hindu Parishad. He was one of the founding members of Vishu Hindu Parishad. And Swami Dayananji wrote the constitution of the Vishu Hindu Parishad. I don't think they're following it enough, but he wrote it. So just to see how they both function together.